Serendipity, such a pleasant sounding word with a pleasant meaning. It means happy mistake, accident, when you find something good or useful without trying. This happens often, or often enough in scientific research, and has led to some of the biggest scientific discoveries. For example, Scottish scientist Andrew Fleming serendipitously discovered penicillin on September 3rd, 1928, after returning from a holiday vacation. Prior to the discovery, there was no effective treatment for infections such as pneumonia, gonorrhea, or rheumatic fever. It was a scary time in medicine because you could go to the hospital after contracting a bacterial infection from a scratch, and doctors could basically do nothing but hope you recover naturally. Fleming is quoted with saying, "I woke up just after dawn on September 28, 1928. I certainly didn't plan to revolutionize all medicine by discovering the world's first antibiotic or bacteria killer, but I suppose that it was exactly what I did." Originally, he was investigating the properties of staphylococci bacteria, which he left in an open petri dish containing the bacteria next to a window in the basement of St. Mary's Hospital in London, now a part of Imperial College. When he returned, he observed some penicillin mold and an area which inhibited bacterial growth. He later published his findings, and penicillin soon thereafter became the first antibiotic. Later on in this course, we will revisit penicillin. Another concept we will address in the future is antibiotics and how they function. However, this drives the importance of making careful observations and collecting data, because sometimes the results reveal something more important and significant, but unrelated to the original purpose of the investigation. This could not be more true than with Timothy Hunt, a British biochemist and molecular physiologist. In the 1980s, he was studying sea urchins as a model for protein synthesis in embryonic cells, but he would discover something much more important. Sea urchin embryos are an excellent model for studying the fertilization of eggs and embryonic development for several reasons. Sea urchins produce eggs for reproduction in very high quantities. These eggs are released outside of their body, and post-fertilization events can be observed with ease. These egg cells are quite large, on average 100 micrometers in diameter. For an extra challenge, in practice with calculating magnification, convert the size of these eggs in millimeters and centimeters. Third, the sea urchin eggs have a clear cytoplasm, which allows us to clearly see the mitotic divisions of the cells. And lastly, sea urchin sperm and eggs are very similar to those of humans, which allows us to make generalizations about our own reproductive physiology at the cellular level. Hunt was working with another scientist, Joan Ruderman, ultimately to understand gene expression in embryos and how cells differentiate through the activation and deactivation of genes in specific cells. It was understood as well that unfertilized sea urchin eggs do not express many of their genes, limiting the amounts and varieties of protein products synthesized through the process of translation. Ruderman and Hunt were studying a variety of marine invertebrates, including clams and starfish, prior to their tests with the sea urchin oocytes. It was toward the end of the sea urchin reproductive season, but the two continued away with their research. In 10-minute intervals, Hunt collected samples from the furiously dividing urchin eggs. From these samples, he extracted and separated radioactively labeled proteins using the technique gel electrophoresis. This allowed him to create proteomes for each sample and discovered a surprising trend. We will revisit the idea of proteomes later in the course when we go into protein structure and function. One protein, which he would later identify as a cyclin protein, increased in concentration in the cells and then mysteriously and rapidly decreased in their concentration. This pattern was observed several times. When he constructed a graph to model the cycling behavior of this protein, he noticed a correlation between cyclin concentration and when the cells underwent a mitotic division. Because great scientific practices encourage extending investigations to explore other relationships, Hunt exposed fertilized sea urchin embryos to various drugs that blocked mitosis in cells and also slowed down the breakdown of cyclins in cells. This type of protein, he concluded, regulated the cell cycle and the rate at which cells would divide. Cyclins are a group of proteins. There are four in particular that vary in concentration throughout the cell cycle. Each one ensures tasks are performed at correct times, like preparation of DNA for replication during the synthesis phase, promoting formation of the spindle apparatus, and more. As you will learn,
Enzymes are at the core of every reaction within living things.
Cyclins become activated when they bind to their enzymes, specifically called cyclin-dependent kinases. Cyclins are also responsible for regulating several genes involved in tumor development. What do you think? Would the absence of cyclins inhibit or stimulate tumor development? I challenge you to find out. This was a revolutionary discovery, especially since it is very difficult to observe the nature of cyclins. In many other species like Drosophila melanogaster, cyclin activity takes place near the nucleus. This makes it even more significant that Hunt chose sea urchins. While Thomas Hunt wasn't working alone and scientific investigations include the collaboration of many, he showed great perseverance and inquiry, qualities of an IB learner. However, this brings up a great question about the serendipity of discovery. To what extent might some of these scientific discoveries be the result of intuition rather than luck?